such a faithful
twilight and the sun. grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Good morning and welcome on this Sunday of our National Thanksgiving Weekend, an opportunity for us to give thanks to God for the riches of this land and for the beauty of this natural world in which we inherit, and for the opportunity to pray in thanksgiving for gratitude in all that God has given us. Let's begin our worship as we pray together the Collect for Purity. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning. Today we're in Brussels and it's hot. So we're under a tree enjoying some cool weather and the breeze and some shade. But this morning I wanted to ask you a question. What do we do to do the right thing or to be a good person? What do you need to do to be a good person? Do you have some ideas? Yeah? Excellent. Okay, so I heard be kind to others, to tell the truth. Okay, what else? Yep, be helpful to those that are either sick or in need. How about giving thanks for all the blessings that we're given? Sort of like this breeze and this shade right now. I need to give thanks for that. In our scripture today, we hear about a man asking Jesus what he needs to do to gain eternal life. And he wants to know that because he wants to know how he can live with God forever. And here's what Jesus says, and I'm going to read it. It says, "With men it is impossible, but not with God. For all things are possible with God." Now, we know the rules for having a good life and how to do the right thing. But you know what? Sometimes it's not that easy. It's hard to do the right thing. And we're not perfect. Only God is perfect. We make some mistakes and we fail at things sometimes. But you know what? If we love one another, if we work together to do what's right, and we thank God for our blessings and who lives within us, then we will have eternal life with God. So the answer to what we must do to have eternal life is this: trust in God. He will love us and he will guide us every day and help us to do what the right things are to be with him. Let's pray. Dearest God, thank you. Thank you for all the blessings that you give to us each and every day. Things as small as a cool breeze on a hot summer's day. And thank you that you live in our hearts and in our minds.
Let us pray. Almighty God, in our baptism you adopted us for your own. Quicken, we pray, your Spirit within us, that we, being renewed both in body and mind, may worship you in sincerity and truth. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
A reading from Book of Hebrews, chapter 4. The word of God is living and active. It is sharper than any sword that has two edges. It cuts deep enough to separate soul from spirit. It can separate joints from bones. It judges the thoughts and purposes of the heart. Nothing God created is hidden from Him. His eye sees everything. He will hold us accountable for everything we do. We have a high priest who can feel it when we are weak and hurting. We have a high priest who has tempted in every way, just as we are. But he did not sin. So let us boldly approach the throne of grace. Then we will receive mercy. We will find grace to help us when we need it. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God.
Also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
As Jesus was setting out on a journey, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not defraud. Honor your father and mother." He said to him, "Teacher, I have kept all of these since my youth." Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said, "You lack one thing. Go and sell what you own and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." When he heard this, he was shocked and went away grieving, for he had many possessions. Then Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God." And the disciples were perplexed at these words. But Jesus said them again, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." They were greatly astounded and said to one another, "Then who can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "For mortals, it's impossible, but not for God. For God, all things are possible." Peter began to say to him, "Look, we have left everything and followed you." Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for my sake and for the sake of the good news, who will not receive 100-fold now in this age, houses, brothers, sisters, mothers, and children, and fields with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I have watched so many movies and shows on Netflix and Prime over the last couple of years that I'm completely spoiled when it comes to not having to look at commercials. So I've lost patience for when I happen to watch something on TV and a commercial comes on. But I do miss some commercials, because sometimes behind the fluff and the stupidity, sometimes the odd commercial says some profound things about human nature. And I'm thinking of one commercial in particular. It was on, I don't know, a few years back, and it was an IKEA commercial. So I don't know if you remember. I think it starts, not too sure about the beginning of it, but I think it starts with a woman and she's at the checkout at IKEA, and she sees the price comes up that she has to pay at the end, and she's just floored that it's so cheap. And then the next scene, the scene that I remember that I'm sure of, she's walking outside the IKEA, she's got high heels on, and she's loaded down with stuff, and she's yelling, "Start the car! Start the car!" Because she knows she's got a really good deal, and she's thinking perhaps she's going to get caught. They're going to realize, oh, no, you owe us a bunch more money. I love that commercial, because I think that Our Lady is a commentary on not just consumerism in the West, how we love stuff, but on the basic human tendency to hold on to things, things of this life, with a ferociousness. We can't even let go of the bad stuff, can we? We fixate on our problems, and we whip them around in our minds like a dog with a stuffed toy, until we are exhausted and ill. Now remember, last time I preached a couple of weeks ago, I asked you to define yourself as a Christian. What makes you stand out in a crowd? Well, I think what God is calling us to as followers of the way is a practice, a way of non-grasping and non-clasping, not holding on to things too tight. Not just our possessions, but to everything that we find in life, internally, externally, even to religion. So let's ponder that today, shall we? So you heard the gospel. We all get the gist of the story, right, of the rich young man whom Jesus encounters. And sure, it's the age-old tension between having lots of stuff and being a follower of Jesus. And wealthy Christians have struggled for centuries with guilt upon hearing this story. And poor Christians have struggled with pride and judgment as they cast stones at the rich for not sharing better. How liberating it is, and what an equalizer, to have the story explained as Jesus' exhortation to all of us, rich or poor or somewhere in the middle, that whatever it is that we are holding on to, we must be willing to give it up if God asks us to. So can we cultivate the practice, the lifestyle, the attitude of letting go? I have come to believe and experience that the degree to which I can cultivate this letting go, this not holding on too tightly to anything, is the degree to which I will reflect the love of God to the world. And I mean all things. As I said, even my understanding, my confession of God. And right now, I think I should be hearing aloud, didn't we just read in Hebrews 4, verse 14? Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast to our confession. Paul goes on to say, we are then able to boldly approach the throne of grace, that we might find mercy and grace to help in the time of need. But my friends, holding on to anything too tightly, in my experience, gets us into trouble. And I believe it is the same for our confession of faith. Psalm 111, verse 10 says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom." But it's not the end. We are on a journey of faith. Faith in a God that is ultimately unknowable, beyond the scope of human language and understanding. And God's Spirit permeates every molecule, every atom of this planet Earth, and goes beyond our earthly home. God's Spirit is everywhere, is encompassed in the stories of God's people, as we read in Holy Scripture, but is certainly not limited to that. In all our doings, we are in touch with divine love, a love that cannot be bound by human understanding and creeds. We are encountering this love, this God, as much as this love, this God is encountering us. I'll say that again. We are encountering this God as much as this God is encountering us. Karl Rahner, a renowned Catholic theologian who lived in the early 20th century, wrote, "The concept of God is not a grasp." There's that word grasp again. "The concept of God is not a grasp of God by which a person masters the mystery, but it is letting oneself be grasped by the mystery which is present." In order to do that, we have to let go of our preconceptions. So as much as we hold on to our confession of the risen Christ, and we must hold on to that, for that, my friends, the resurrection is life itself. Remember that Christ, as the Son of the living God, this love is also a mystery, beyond human understanding, and not to be boxed in and clutched at with a vice grip. If we do so, if we clutch on and hold on to our perhaps limited understanding of Jesus Christ and the message of the cross, sometimes we will miss the presence of Christ today, right under our noses, in ways that we have dared not define as Christ before. As we ponder our faith with a posture of openness and malleability, this compassionate love, this God, this Christ, will descend into the innermost recesses of our doubts and fears. And in the words of Rahner, "An encounter such as this melts everything that we cling to in the love that sets us free." Let us pray. God of grace and love and mystery, help us not to hold on to anything in this world or within ourselves too tightly. Even as we hold on to our faith, let us do so with humility. Open our hearts and kindle our imaginations, that we might see you, Jesus, at work in new ways. Surprise us, Lord, as we journey together. Amen.
Let us confess the faith of our baptism as we say, "I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For peace from on high and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For our bishops and for all the clergy and people, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For Elizabeth, our Queen, and for the leaders of the nation, and for all in authority, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this city, for every city and community, and for those who live in them in faith, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For good weather and for abundant harvest for all to share, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who travel by land, water, or air, for the sick and the suffering, for prisoners and captives, and for their safety, health, and salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For our deliverance from all affliction, strife, and need, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the absolution and remission of our sins and offenses, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For all who have died, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Remembering all the saints, we commit ourselves, one another, and our whole life to Christ our God, to Thee, O Lord. Almighty God, who has given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplications unto Thee, and those promised that when two or three are gathered together in Thy name, Thou wilt hear their request, fulfill now, O Lord, the desires and petitions of Thy servants as may be most expedient for them, granting us in this world knowledge of Thy truth, and in the world to come life everlasting. For Thou, Father, art good and loving, and we glorify Thee through Thy Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and the Holy Spirit, now for and ever. Amen.
Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites us to His presence. Let us confess our sins then, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against You in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved You with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of Your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in Your will and walk in Your ways to the glory of Your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to life everlasting through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. My sisters, my brothers in Christ, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
All of you is more than enough for all of me.
Thank you.
Let us pray. God of constant love, you renew the covenant made once with us in baptism. As you are faithful in all things, may we in our offering be faithful to our calling. This we ask in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray. Faithful God, in baptism and Eucharist, we are made one with you. May we always bear witness to your covenant. This we ask in the name of Jesus Christ the Lord. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Don't forget that next Sunday at 12 noon, we will be having our annual vestry meeting. All members of our congregation are encouraged to attend. Any materials that you will need, the vestry report, and of course financial information, will be available on our parish website. If you haven't already downloaded that, please go and do so today. We look forward to seeing you next Sunday at 12 noon for our annual vestry meeting.
Oh, wondrous things hath done.
My brothers and sisters, our worship has ended. Our service now begins. Go forth in the name of Christ.
Thanks be to God.